Let's shift a little bit to the question of buying sperm, right? So tell us a little bit about the prices paid by people who buy sperm. I presume there's some markup between what the sperm donor is paid and what they receive on the other end?
Absolutely. These are businesses, after all, for-profit businesses. The sperm donor is walking in, being paid $100 to $150 for that sample. The sperm bank takes that sample and can create anywhere from 0 vials, if the sperm count isn't high enough, to 1 or 2, to as many as 8 or 9 vials from that single sample that they've paid about $125 for. Then the sperm bank will turn around, they have to freeze it for 6 months, retest the donor for HIV, and then they put that sample on the market. So there is a wide infrastructure that's in place for making sure that that sperm is then safe to sell. And so the sperm banks, they have a number of costs that they're trying to manage. However, when they turn around and sell those vials, they're selling them for $500, $600, $700, depending on the specific characteristics of the sperm. Those are technical characteristics. For somebody who would like to purchase sperm in order to try to have a child, they rarely get pregnant on the first time, and you're buying multiple vials. And so this can very quickly add up to be quite an expensive proposition.
And one not typically covered by health insurance or anything else, right?
That's correct, yeah.
And tell me a little bit about how the way in which individual sperm donors are marketed to families who are thinking about using a sperm donor. What kinds of information about the sperm donor are typically provided?
Yeah, well, this has really changed over time. So sperm donation has more than a century of history behind it. And for most of the 20th century, it was very anonymous, very secretive, and it was really the doctors who were in charge.
Yeah, the doctor would pick somebody actually to be a sperm donor, right? Or in some cases, it's alleged used his own sperm and stuff like that.
Exactly. There have certainly been cases of that, legal cases of that. So what would typically happen is a heterosexual couple would come in and say to the doctor, we've had trouble getting pregnant. They would be evaluated. And then the doctor would go into the next room, pull a medical resident or a medical student off the floor, ask them to provide a sample.
Wow.
It was then fresh insemination, right? So with the advent of AIDS in the 1980s, this became no longer tenable. And sperm banks started these large, you know, businesses with the freezing and the shipping and the evaluations and the screening and all of that. So over time, the amount of information about the donor and also the consumer's agency in this process has really increased. So now if you go to a sperm bank, you'll get, you know, 25 to 50 pages of information about that donor, the health history, and answers to all kinds of questions like, what was your favorite book as a child? Why do you want to be a donor? You know, describe your hair and your skin and your height and your manual dexterity, right? So all of these questions are now made available to consumers who can click through and decide what kind of characteristics that they want in their donor.
Are there particular traits that are particularly valued, either paid more for by the sperm bank or particularly valued by consumers?
Yeah, and so this is another interesting difference that emerges when you're looking at sperm banks versus egg agencies. And so sperm banks have a number of requirements that really reflect our cultural expectations for masculinity. So sperm donors have to be at least 5'8" or 5'9" tall. Short sperm doesn't sell. Men have to be enrolled in college or have a 4-year degree. And if you then switch over to the egg agencies, they don't have that same height requirement. They don't have that same education requirement. So we know that your height and your education does not appear in any one place on your DNA, but that you inherit elements of those characteristics from both parents. And so why do we need tall, educated sperm donors, but we don't need tall, educated egg donors? And I think that's one of the places where when you compare these two markets, you can really see cultural norms around gender emerging and infusing the way that the market operates.
So what about ethnicity? Are there particular ethnicities that are harder to find in the market? Are there premiums paid for some ethnicities?
Well, this again is another difference between sperm banks and egg agencies. So sperm banks will pay the same rate to all of the men in the bank. There are some banks that in the past have paid extra for men with PhDs, but in terms of ethnicity, sperm banks will really just complain about the difficulty they have in recruiting men from a diverse range of backgrounds. So they might bend their expectations in terms of those height requirements or their education requirements in order to get men from a diverse array of backgrounds in the door. In egg agencies, they actually do pay women more if they come from racial or ethnic backgrounds that they consider hard to recruit. So African-American women donors, Asian-American women donors will often command a few $1,000s more than white donors. And that's interesting sociologically because this is one of the few markets where women of color do better than white women in terms of labor market outcomes.
That's fascinating.
Yeah.
Can you talk a little bit about the differences between anonymous versus open identification sperm banks?
Yeah, so again, this is sort of a historical shift. In the early days of sperm donation, as I mentioned, it was completely anonymous, secretive. Often records weren't even kept, so certainly recipients had no idea who the donor was and vice versa. And this really shifted along with demographic changes in the number of same-sex couples. So there was a sperm bank that grew out of the feminist women's health movement, and they were really oriented to serving the lesbians and single women in the late 70s, early 80s, who were barred from mainstream sperm banks. So mainstream sperm banks would not send sperm to lesbians or single women, saying that they didn't actually have infertility. So this, you know, feminist-oriented sperm bank opens up, and they start selling sperm to lesbians and single women who said, it'd be really great if we could find out more about our donor, or maybe our children could meet the donor someday. So the very first, what they call identity release program, opened in around 1980, 1981. And that became something that then migrated to more mainstream sperm banks as the mainstream sperm banks became more open to serving these same-sex couples and single women that they had previously been discriminating against.
Are there any noticeable difference these days between the ways in which lesbian women or single women select sperm donors as opposed to heterosexual couples?
So the number of heterosexual couples who have to go to sperm banks to treat their infertility is actually dramatically reduced. And that happened after the development of ICSI, I-C-S-I, which is intracytoplasmic sperm injection. In the mid-1990s, this is a technology that if they could find a single sperm in the male body, they could inject it directly into the egg. And so heterosexual couples that can afford IVF with ICSI now really prefer that technology because it allows them to have a genetically related child. So this is that shift I was talking about, where the sperm banks were mostly serving heterosexual clients. They saw that population drop in the 90s. They start opening up their doors to the lesbians and single women. When I talk to sperm bank owners and people who work in sperm banks, they say absolutely that the considerations are different for heterosexual couples and lesbians. Lesbians have no reason to hide the fact that they needed to purchase sperm, whereas heterosexual couples were really focused on trying to match the husband's physiognomy in order to make sure that people didn't guess that he wasn't the real father. So the sort of secrecy and anonymity along with the demographics of the customers have really changed how this market works.
Can you tell us a little bit about the international market for sperm? So one thing I've read is that actually Danish sperm is particularly exported?
Yes, so this is the phenomenon of the Viking sperm banks. So the Denmark is actually the largest exporter of sperm in the world. They have a website that is festooned with little blonde, blue-eyed babies, and this is the idea that they really have sperm that people want. And part of why Denmark has become such a large exporter of sperm is because several of the other European countries have exerted quite a lot of regulation on sperm banks and sperm donation. So one example here is France. It's a national sperm bank, a nationalized sperm bank, but they only allow heterosexual couples access to sperm. So lesbians and single women in France then need to turn elsewhere. So this is part of the market that the Viking sperm bank is serving.
Great. And just to pick two things out of that, one is it seems to be that there's a bit of a eugenic impulse, and we'll talk about this at a later portion of the course, right? Certain traits are valued or thought to be valued. The other is this idea of trying to circumvent domestic regulation by importing, right? So they don't like the way in which France regulates sperm. So for a lesbian couple, they may import sperm from Denmark rather than dealing with the French authorities and their regulation.
Right, exactly.
Well, the last thing I want to ask you about sperm is we've talked a lot about sperm donation in the sense of men who sell sperm and people who buy sperm. How are things different at all between true donation, altruistic donation, if you will?
Well, one of the really interesting elements of this market that has been emerging in the last few years is really due to internet traffic in sperm. So there's been a couple of journalistic exposés of men who offer their sperm online for free to all comers. And so this is an example of altruistic sperm donation. I'm not sure if it's quite the type that you were asking me about, but that is a completely unknown underbelly of this market. And we are just starting sort of sociological and anthropological studies of how that market is operating.
And later in this course, we'll actually talk about the case of the Craigslist sperm donor who the state of Kansas went after for child support. And that'll be something we'll talk about, which is great. Yeah.